The new year is always a great time to go through your toolkit and make sure you're getting the most out of your game dev workflow. With 2026 drawing to a close, I think it's a great time to share the tools I used to develop an award-winning game for PC and consoles, the tools I'm using for my next game, and a few new tools I'm thinking about picking up in 2026. Of course, if you have any recommendations, feel free to drop those below. Starting with the art side, I make 3D games and I use Blender for all of my modeling and animation. I used to use tools like ProBuilder and uMotion, which let you do this inside of Unity, and while these are super helpful, I just found that they became way too slow as the project grew, so having a dedicated external modeling tool just works much better for me. I also have to say that any tool with modifiers or layers that can be blended without having to apply destructive changes is always a huge win for me, and Blender is great for that. Blender certainly has a bit of a learning curve and it does have some quirks, but it gets better and better every day, and there are loads of plugins and great resources out there for learning. Two Blender plugins that I love, both which are paid but are worth every penny, are AutoRig Pro and Faceit. If you're rigging, animating, or retargeting in Blender, then AutoRig Pro really is fantastic, and if you want to incorporate facial animation in your game, then Faceit has some brilliant features that just make it honestly much easier and much more accessible for a solo indie dev. I also have a Rococo smart suit for animation. Now, full disclosure, this was a paid sponsorship that I did a few months ago, but honestly, it's been a huge help and I can't thank Rococo enough for sending me the suit. For texturing, Material Maker is a free and open source tool that I used a fair bit with Farewell North, but I haven't been using so much for my new game. Still, it's a really great tool, it's very powerful, it lets you create textures procedurally with a node-based editor, which you can then export straight into your game. It has a pretty active community that shares loads of Creative Commons textures, which you are then able to use and edit yourself. I've heard great things about Substance Painter, and that's a tool I'm definitely keen on learning next year. My understanding is that this wouldn't really replace Material Maker, but it's more for painting specific textures rather than generating procedural textures, and that's something that's really missing in my workflow right now. I currently use a combination of Blender's texture painting and GIMP, which is also free and open source and an alternative to Photoshop. I won't pretend it's anywhere near as powerful as Photoshop, but it's free, it has virtually all the same core features, and did I mention it's free? For texturing, it doesn't really compare with Material Maker, but it does have a lot of noise generation tools and it can generate normal maps, so I've actually been using this much more than Material Maker lately. I want to get back to practicing Material Maker, but I just haven't been for whatever reason, so that's one to focus on improving in the new year. I use Texture Packer to generate sprite sheets. Even for 3D games, I actually get a lot of use out of this, packing sprite sheets for UI and input prompts, for example. And if you're making 2D games, then I really highly recommend this one. You drop all your images in, and it generates an optimized sprite sheet based on the conditions that you give it, which can then be exported with game engine specific config files, so your engine knows exactly how to use all the sprites, you don't need to manually slice anything. I do use the paid version of this, which I found well worth money, but there's a free version as well. A great little tool recommended by one of our Discord members, Gopher, is PureRef, a handy little app that lets you pin any image onto your screen. This makes for a very helpful reference when you're trying to model and texture something and you want to use some reference images. I found it really quite frustrating bouncing back and forth between GIMP and Blender and Material Maker and your game engine and so on and so forth. You'd have to set up your reference images in each, but with PureRef, the reference images just stay there right on top. Super handy little tool, and again, you can get this one for free. All right, it's time for the part of the video I know is going to be the most controversial. Now, let's get this out of the way. I use Unity. There are a lot of things I wish were different about it, particularly the company and their trend chasing, but the engine itself is a great general purpose tool, and Unity 6 has made some big steps in the right direction, in my opinion, after years of poor management. I'm hoping that they continue down this path, but obviously only time will tell. And for now, there's nothing really in the other major engines that would be worth switching for. A few rapid-fire Unity assets and libraries I feel are worth mentioning. VatBaker is a great free open source plugin for generating vertex animation textures, so you can bake animations into a simple texture, sample it from your shaders, and get massive performance for flocks and crowds. RTLTM Pro, quite a mouthful, but it's a fork of TextMesh Pro that has proper support for right-to-left languages like Arabic, which might be helpful for you. Ambient CG Importer, it's a really handy little script to import textures from Ambient CG and auto-generate all the materials and the Unity-specific textures that you need. Ragdoll Helper is exactly what it says, a simple little script that helps you set up ragdolls. Salsa is a great tool for procedural lip-sync. It's far from perfect, but it gets the job done, and if you can't afford to author lip-sync animations by hand, it's a great starting point. I also use Unity's Live Capture Package for facial animation and lip sync, but I need to do some research on this. I'm pretty sure there are better tools out there for lip sync, so if you have any recommendations, please do leave them down below. Feel is a great set of tools to add all kinds of juice to your games. I'm pretty late to this one and just started picking it up recently, but I'm already finding it very, very helpful, and I'll definitely be diving more deeply into it in 2026. Last but not least, Mesh Combine Studio is a very powerful tool for automatically combining meshes in your scene, and it gives much better performance than simple static batching. For my IDE, I use JetBrains Writer. I really enjoy the whole JetBrains suite. Their refactoring tools are great. They do also have a direct integration into Unity, which is really nice, but to be honest, I don't really make as much use of it as I should. There's probably some productivity gains I'm missing out on there, so maybe something for 2026. One big wishlist item for Writer is I wish they had better HLSL support. I would really love to see them invest a bit more in shader tooling, so hopefully we'll see that in the future. For source control, I really love Git, though I will admit it has some shortcomings when it comes to games and large binary files. Still, I feel right at home with Git, and I haven't really seen anything game-specific that's tempted me away just yet. I pair Git with GitHub, just the free tier. I used to use GitHub for issues and project management, but I've moved all of that out of GitHub this year to a new tool, which I'll talk about later. I've been using this Unity Blender GIMP stack since 2014 or so, when I first started learning Unity. What's great about being comfortable with your tools is it means that you can focus on building and learning your craft. And a great way to continue learning is with the sponsor of today's video, Brilliant. See, Brilliant helps you excel in math and computer science, two skills that are tremendously valuable if you're making games. With visual, interactive problem solving, and personalized practice, Brilliant is designed to be highly effective. You learn through active problem solving, a method that research has shown to be far more powerful than watching lectures or videos. Brilliant personalizes learning for you, and I've been using this opportunity to brush up on some calculus that I haven't used in years. It starts you at the right level based on your background, designs practice sets and reviews personalized for you, and helps you advance at your ideal pace. Brilliant is crafted by an award-winning team of teachers, researchers, and professionals from MIT, Harvard, Stanford, Caltech, Google, and more. Brilliant believes that everyone is a math person. It's just the way that we learn math that can feel confusing and difficult. On Brilliant, you don't just memorize formulas, you get hands-on with concepts until they actually make sense. And if you watched my last video, you know I preach that as the best way to learn. To learn for free on Brilliant for a full 30 days, go to brilliant.org/kylebanks, scan the QR code on screen, or click the link in the description. Brilliant's also giving you guys 20% off an annual premium subscription, which gives you unlimited daily access to everything on Brilliant. Thank you so much to Brilliant for sponsoring this video. On the audio side, I work with a composer for my games. Shout out to the fantastic John Consolakis. At this point, we've been working together for quite a few years now. The best way we found to work together is with FMod, which essentially lets him program the audio, set up the logic, and implement everything exactly how he wants it, and then he lets me know what data he needs from the engine and when to trigger various events. Then it's up to me to simply check off his requirements and provide the necessary data from Unity to FMod for his implementation to do its thing. It's a great system, it saves me loads of time, and it lets us create really complicated adaptive audio that actually won John and Ivor Novello for the Farewell North soundtrack. I have heard people say that FMod somehow makes console ports difficult, but that's not been my experience at all. I ported Farewell North to Nintendo Switch, Xbox, and PlayStation 5 myself, and FMod was not a concern. The only thing to watch out for is on one of the consoles, I can't say which, it does have size limits on updates, so if you release your game and then you were to swap out all the audio, it's definitely going to cause you problems. But that's not really anything to do with FMod, and you'd have the same problem no matter where you put that audio. And Unity's default audio engine is actually built on a basic version of FMod, so the idea that it wouldn't run on certain platforms just doesn't really make much sense. Even though I work with John, I do end up using Audacity quite a bit to create placeholder sound effects and edit all of the lines from our voice actors. We also recorded every line of Kaylee's dialogue in Audacity. It's just another free, classic tool that just works and has tons of tutorials and resources out there to learn from. When it comes to planning and organization, I'm a big Notion fan. I use it to organize literally everything in my life. I know Notion is a big YouTube sponsor. I've never been sponsored by Notion, but hey, Notion, if you're watching. No, I honestly just love the tool. It's replaced GitHub Issues as my daily task list, and I also keep all my goals, writing, ideas, video scripts, you name it, it's all in Notion. I'm just on the free tier and it finally gives me everything I need, so I've seen no need to upgrade currently. Now let's talk a little bit about video editing. Obviously this applies to YouTube, but I also had some live footage in Farewell North, and I have a lot more in my new game, not to mention trailers and social posts. I do all my editing in DaVinci Resolve. Again, I'm just using the free version of DaVinci, and that's been working really well for me for the last few years. I did purchase a noise reduction plugin, which removes some of the graining on my old cheap webcam. It's not so much an issue anymore with my new camera, but it's still a helpful tool to have. Speaking of which, I'm using a Sony ZV-E10, which is just your basic entry-level vlogging camera. We're using this to film some live-action scenes for the new game, and at this point I've just got an entire closet full of tripods and lights. I also have a teleprompter, which mounts right onto the lens, and you place your phone in there, and it just reflects nice and clearly onto the camera, so you can read your script as you're recording. Otherwise, it would take me like 10 times longer to get these videos done. I've gone through several mics over the years, but currently I use two. So this is the Blue Yeti. I've been using this one for quite a while now, and we recorded all of the Feral North voice acting for Kaylee with this mic. And I also have a pair of wireless lapel mics we're using for the live action shots, and I'll probably use these a little bit more if I ever do any YouTube videos that don't, you know, involve me sitting at my desk. I find buying video equipment quickly becomes a little bit of a hobby on its own somehow, and I'm always picking up little new pieces here and there that just kind of help make my workflow easier. And I'm sure 2026 won't be much different there. I also really enjoy the idea of incorporating more live action scenes into my games, and it's a very different form of directing to learn, so I'm really excited to dig into that a little bit more as well. So that's my toolkit for game dev in 2026, but what are you using? Let me know if there's something that you think I'm missing down below. Huge shout out to all of my patrons, with a special thanks to my magpies and my ospreys Elagon, Jason Hansen, Ellie Swale, Justice Lind, Brennan Pung, Peter James, Will Todd, Mags, Neil Blakey Milner, Peter Randall, Alex Zed, Jason Lin, Guillermo Angel, Andrus Martin, Cool Cal Cool, Nathaniel Morit, and Alan Halstead. That's all for this one. I will see you guys next time.